Afternoon, everyone. My name is Matt Shantz. I'm a lawyer with Frost Brown Todd of our Indianapolis office. We have offices in eight states, 12 or 13 cities. Hard to keep up with all of them. But I do intellectual property law, patents, trademarks, and software type work. The getting and the licensing, not the duping it out in the court. My clients are usually happy to call me. They're excited about what they're doing, not worried about getting sued. Frost Brown Todd, in not just the IP section, but lots of our practice groups, has picked up on blockchain as a technology and as an opportunity for businesses, broadly speaking, for several months now. And we're here to help get you thinking about some of those ideas, too. And if you're not up to speed on what blockchain is, then we're going to start. My colleague William here is going to get the basics in your head to start out with, and then I'll pick up for the second half and talk about some opportunities, business opportunities, some of the risks involved that you might appreciate as you go along. Even if you don't know blockchain or you know computer security, you'll understand some of the problems as William talks about how things are structured. I might lay those out a little more explicitly and then speak to some opportunities. So I'm going to hand it to William right now and see what I have.
Excellent. Thanks a lot, Matt. So as you said, I'm going to talk a little bit about the basics, and I want to do three things. The first thing is I want to make clear just what a blockchain actually is, because it has some neat technical features that will drive the discussion of risks and risk mitigation and opportunities that Matt's going to go into. I want to talk about what those features are, of course. That's thing number two, so I have three. I just split number one into one and two. And I'm also going to talk about some applications, right? Because this isn't just a theoretical technology. People are actually using the blockchain right now and making a lot of money, and in some cases, a lot of mistakes doing it. So I'll be talking about what they're doing, and Matt will be talking, I think, about some of the mistakes that are going to be fixed. So first, what is the blockchain? Well, in general, it's like a record-keeping system, and it's built on a foundation of three technologies: hashing, public and private keys, and a thing called a NOS. So hashing, this is just, it's used to make sure you're not messing with or altering any records. So you put in some input to a thing called a hash function, and you get some output. And it looks random, but it's going to be the same thing whenever you put in the same input. And let me give you an example of how this might work to prevent someone from altering things. So we're going to imagine that the U.S. federal government is very technologically savvy, and they believe our laws are very important. And so they are going to put the U.S. code, they're going to hash it, right? They're going to put it into a hash function, they get out a hash value. Now, I don't know what that hash value is, right? It's essentially random, but this is now the hash value for the U.S. code. And let's further imagine, in addition to the U.S. federal government being both technically savvy and public-spirited, that there's some horrible catastrophe, and Washington, D.C. is destroyed, and we've lost this master copy of the U.S. code that they created this hash value with. Well, happily, I am a lawyer, and as all lawyers do, I have a copy of the U.S. code on my hard drive. And so I am going to go into the smoking ruins of Washington, D.C., right into the rescue, and say, I have a copy of the U.S. code. Society can go on. There will be continuity. The world is saved. Unfortunately, there is also a person, I shall call him Snidely Whiplash. He comes with me. He arrives at the same time. He says, I have a copy of the U.S. code. But being a dastardly sort, Mr. Whiplash has actually altered the U.S. code to give special preferences to his religious and ethnic group, because he's dastardly. Now, how are we going to deal with this? Because there's no master copy any longer, right? It was destroyed in the asteroid or the meteor or whatever got rid of Washington, D.C. What we're going to do is we're going to take my copy, we're going to put it in the hash function. We're going to take Mr. Whiplash's copy and put it in the hash function. Mine's going to give you a value that matches, because even though it looks random, it's going to be the same at the same input. Mr. Whiplash's version is going to be different. And I don't know how it's going to be different, right? It's essentially random. But whatever it is, we'll immediately be able to tell that that copy is modified and not the real U.S. code, and throw it out because the hash value won't match. And that's essentially how it's also used in the blockchain. It's used to make sure that records aren't modified or surreptitiously changed. So that's the first pillar of blockchain technology. The second is public and private keys. And this is used in order to establish people's identity, to make sure they are who they say they are, they have the permissions that they say they have. And what this is, it's basically a pair of numbers where I can sign something with my private key, and then it's just validatable only with my public key. So a really common way of doing this is your private key might be like an encryption key. So I'm going to encrypt it with my private key, and then you would only be able to decrypt it with my public key. Let me sort of give another example to show how this might work to allow you to establish an identity, right? So let's say I and my good friend Matt, we're both big football fans. We make a bet. And the bet is that Andy Dalton will be the Super Bowl MVP, the quarterback of the Bengals. And then the next day I wake up and I say, oh my God, what was I doing? Well, maybe we'll get to the Super Bowl, but that's probably another story. And so I say, I am not going to make this bet. I will never pay this off. And so in October, when we don't make the playoffs, Matt comes and says, pay off the bet. And I say, that wasn't me. Someone forged my little name on that. I did not actually make that bet with you. I'm sorry, no go. But if I've signed it, if I've kind of put my digital signature with my private key, what Matt will do is he'll validate it with the public key. So if I encrypted the bet, made an encrypted copy with my private key, he will decrypt it with the public key and he'll say, well, William, in fact, that can't be right. Because when I decrypted this with your public key, it wasn't gibberish. It worked. And it says, William will pay Matt some amount of money if and when Andy Dalton is in Super Bowl MVP. And if that hadn't been you, if someone had forged it like you said, I couldn't have done that because they wouldn't have known your secret private key. So that's how you can use these public-private key pairs to establish identity. And again, that's also how they're essentially used on the blockchain and what they're used for. And then the final thing is a nonce. And I'll say this is like a waste of time. What it actually is like a number that can only be obtained by expending a significant amount of resources. And there's different kinds of nonces. But in general, what they're used for is preventing inconsistent or fraudulent transactions. And I'll give you an example of how this would work too, right? So let's say I have a digital asset of some kind, and I'm going to sell it to my friend Matt Shantz, and I do, and yay, good for me. But, I still have a copy of that thing on my hard drive, so I'm also going to sell it to someone else. I'll sell it to my friend Jill over there. And unless Jill knows that I already sold it to Matt, they're going to have these inconsistent rights, and I will have both of their money. So good for me, not so much for them, not so much for the asset in general, because people won't be able to trust it. So in order to deal with this, what Matt and Jill can do is they can say, I'm not going to treat a transaction as closed until you have a nonce value. And in this case, I'm going to say the nonce, it's like just a random number, where when I put that nonce together with the file that says I'm transferring it, and then put it into a hash value, it gives me some random output that has a lot of zeros in front, like 30 zeros. And if they say that, I'll say, okay, fine. I'm going to do my transaction with you, Matt, and I'll start with a nonce 1. And I put it in, does it have 30 zeros in the front? No, right? Because the odds of it having that are like 1 in 2 to the 30, and I'm not that lucky. Okay, so now I'll do it 2 and 3 and 4, and I keep going. Ultimately, I'm going to find this because computers are very fast. But they're not so fast that I will find it before that transaction has kind of propagated through the network and where other people who might care about it, like Jill, will have found out that I already sold my digital asset to Matt. And so because it sort of slows things down, this nonce has prevented me from making a fraudulent transaction or selling it and having inconsistent rights between Jill and Matt because I've used the nonce that way. And again, that's essentially how it's used in the blockchain. And so those are the three foundational pillars. And I just want to walk through the process of creating and then transferring a digital asset using those pillars. So first, I'm going to create an asset called a William coin. And you say, well, I've never heard of a William coin. That's not a thing. And I say, no problem. I'm going to bring it into existence. I'm going to make a file that says, I have a William coin. And now I do. So problem number one solved. Number two, I'm going to establish control over it as myself. And the way I'm going to do this is I'm going to make myself a public and private key pair, right? Because that's what they're used for. And I am going to take my public key and I'm going to put it into the hash function, which gives me a semi-random but consistent value. And I'm going to put that into my file that says I have 1 million coin. And I'm also going to make a rule. And here's my rule. My rule says no one can claim to own this William coin unless they have a public key that generates that hash, right? So if they have a number, they say this is a public key, they put it into the hash value. If it's the same thing, then maybe they're going to be able to do it. But they also have to have a private key that they can use to make a digital signature that public key will decrypt. So there's like two layers of identity maintenance here. There's one, they have to know my public key because otherwise they can't generate the hash. And two, they have to know my private key because otherwise they can't generate a digital signature that public key will be able to validate. So I make these rules, I add the public key, and that establishes my identity. And now I'm gonna hash the whole thing to make it tamper resistant, right? Because if anyone tampers with it, the hash is not gonna match anymore, and I'll be able to tell that they messed with it and repudiate that file. So I now have a William coin, and no one else can say that they have it, and no one can modify it, for instance, by putting their public key in instead of my public key. But having a digital asset, I mean, you don't want to have a William coin, you want to spend a William coin. So let's go to step two, which is how to transfer it. Very, very similar to what we did in the first one, right? So first we're going to make clear what it is I'm transferring, and we're going to do that with a hash. We're going to take the hash of that first file that says I have a William coin. We're going to put it into the second one, and because hashes are kind of tied to whatever their input is, this is going to tie it to that original William coin. And then I'm going to establish who it's going to be transferred to. So if I'm transferring it to Matt, I'll say, Matt, generate me up a public and private key, and just give me the hash of your public key. And then exactly the same way as I put the hash of my public key in the first one, I'm going to put the hash of his public key in this one. And the same rules will apply if he wants to transfer it. And now I'm going to make sure it's clear that I'm the one, me, the owner from the first William coin file, who's authorized this transaction. And the way I'm going to do that is I'm going to take my public key, I'll put it in the file. And now if anyone wants to know, is this the same person, they can take my public key, put it into the hash function, it'll get the same number, and therefore it matches, and so same person. And I'm also going to sign the whole thing, right? I'm going to take this transaction, I'm going to sign it with my private key, and that gives you yet another layer of I'll call it assurance of my identity. Because someone might know my public key, especially because I just put it in the file, right? Now everybody knows my public key, but they don't know my private key. And so only the person who originally generated that William coin is gonna be able to do both layers of that digital signature, and so it's now clear that this file is something that is authorized by me, the original owner. And of course, I'm gonna hash the whole thing to make it tamper resistant. So now I have established the existence of a William coin. I have made it so that you can't tamper with it or say you own it when you don't, and I have transferred it in a way that is also tamper resistant and clearly tied to one person, in this case Matt, but it could have been anyone. But I haven't solved the problem that I can still transfer it to Jill at the same time, right? And that's where the nonces are going to come in. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my transaction and I'm going to put it into a block with a whole bunch of other transactions. And the reason is because nonces are kind of a pain in the neck to make. And so I want it to be worth it for a lot of transactions, but you're not going to spend the time making nonces for every individual little transfer. And then I'm somehow going to acquire or bring to bear sufficient computing time to actually generate an appropriate nonce, like do all that guessing and checking that we talked about, where you're trying to find some nonce that gives you a hash value with 30 zeros in the front. And when I say acquire, I'm actually being deliberately vague here. So I could do that by buying a server. I could do that by going to Amazon and buying some of their EC2, their Elastic Computing facility. But I could also get you guys to give me the computing power. And that's what my goal is, because I don't want to either buy it or go to Amazon. And we're going to talk a little bit about how I'm going to get you guys to give me your computing power in order to validate my transaction. But in any case, I'm going to acquire this computing power. And now Jill, she won't close the transaction until that nonce is generated. And in fact, she can actually make it even more secure. And what she can do is she can say, all right, I'm not going to wait until you generate your nonce, or there's a nonce generated for our block of transactions. I'm going to chain the blocks together by waiting until there's another block, and then that block is going to have the hash of the block you're in right now, right, the fingerprint, so they are sort of a chain of blocks, or a block chain, if you would coin a phrase. And she's going to wait to close the transaction until my block, the block with our transaction, is actually buried like six rows deep. And so the longer, the more it's buried, the more nonsense had to be created, the more computing resources had to be expended, the harder it's going to be for me to fake, and the more time it's going to be for whoever's looking at these files, or if they're on a network, for the network to propagate through, so she can be more sure that I'm not selling her something that I've already sold to someone else and don't have rights to any longer. And so what we have here is kind of cool, right? This is the blockchain, or a version of the blockchain, where it's immutable. You can easily make sure that something isn't being copied by using these nonces. And it's hard to fake because of all the resources you have to go in to actually close any transaction. And so what I want to do now is talk about some of the features of this that come out of it, and also compare it to some existing technology. And I'm going to start with a comparison. And I'm going to do that by comparing it to just the distributed database, right, which also is a record-keeping system. And by the way, I stand by it. When I say that blockchain is a record-keeping system, 100% accurate, kind of unfair, because it's both more and less than that. If I'm going to evaluate it based on traditional database principles, blockchains are actually pretty terrible. So let's look at your standard database operations, CRUD, create, read, update, and delete. Well, can we create records on the blockchain? Yes, we can, right? I just did. I created a record of my transfer, I created my William coin, but it was kind of a pain, right? It was very inefficient, intentionally inefficient to create these records, whereas with a distributed database, you're not intentionally making it hard. You don't have to guess 2 to the 30 hashes in order to update a record in a distributed database, because that's not what it does. So yeah, I can create, but I'm bad at it on the blockchain. All right, what about reading a record, right? Well, you've got all these records, and Jill can see my record of my trade with Matt, so reading is certainly possible. But again, that's not really what it's designed for. I mean, you can go through, but if I want to know, is William, did William transfer something to Matt, I kind of have to like trace back through. It's not like an indexed thing like a relational database where I can easily go through and find out where is the transaction history for this particular record. So I can read it, right? I can search through the whole chain, but it's a pain. So it's worse on reading, okay? What about updating? Well, it's terrible on updating because you can't do it. I mean, that's the whole point, is updating a record, you're not gonna update it. So far we've got worse on create, worse on read, and you can't even compare on update. Delete is exactly the same. You can't delete a record. So that's why it keeps going forward, is I've attached the keyboard. All right, so it's worse on delete, but let's talk about what it's good for, which I inadvertently did by touching that keyboard. So it's good, and the thing, features that make it so exciting, the first is it's super decentralized. No one needs to be responsible or in charge of a blockchain. On a distributed database, there's going to be a DBA, there's going to be various concurrency things. But here, since the records are effectively immutable, and I can easily validate they haven't been tampered by looking at the hash and just running it through the same hash function to see if it matches, I don't care who's storing them. And I don't care who's validating them. In fact, it can be Snidely Whiplash, from my earlier examples. Because if Snidely decides to modify it, it'll be immediately obvious to me. And if he doesn't decide to modify it, then he's just contributed his computing power and his storage to making my blockchain work better. So I'd love Snidely to have a copy of this and to take responsibility for maintaining it, because the blockchain allows anyone to do it and I don't have to trust them at all. Now, why would Snidely do that though, right? He's a bad person. Well, that's the other thing about a blockchain, is it has super strong network effects and it kind of brings its own incentive structure. So let's say someone has a William coin, right? That makes William coins more valuable to everyone else because that person who has it is a potential customer who wants to spend a William coin. And so whatever negligible value it had before, it now has negligible plus one. All right, but we're not gonna just send it to one person, right? This is a network, it's gonna be a lot of people. But also, when you have a William coin, like Matt has a William coin, he wants to be the person who makes that network more than just Matt and William, because he wants other people to be in it, because that will make his William coin more valuable. So there's a lot of network effects and a lot of incentives for people to spread these things, and I can use that to convince anyone, even Snidely, to to donate computing power to me. And what I'll do is I'll say, if you validate one of these blocks, I'm going to give you as a reward, you're going to have some billion coins of your own, and then you can spend them. And I'm sure people here in this room, some of you have heard the term like Bitcoin mining. That's what that is. You do your work of validating, and then you get Bitcoins, and then you now have Bitcoins, and so you want to do more validating and spread them more and make Bitcoins more valuable. And the network effects really come from that, which you don't really have so much with a distributed database. So it's a little bit different. It's a record-keeping system, but you can't look at it as a record-keeping system because it's terrible at that. You have to look at it as something more. And what it is it's this kind of immutable, it's almost like a tidal chain that has these network effects that anyone can get involved in. All right, so what are some applications? That was the third thing I said I would talk about today. First, of course, everyone's heard of Bitcoin. I'm using this as a record of transfers for things. They have no real intrinsic value, but people have decided that they do have value, and they'll treat them as though they have value, and therefore they do have value. And in fact, that has been really successful. I think the price of Bitcoin is now hovering at something like $4,500 per Bitcoin. So no intrinsic value, but in fact, it's been very effective at creating a lot of wealth for a lot of people. But you can move beyond just cryptocurrencies and saying, I transfer this arbitrary data thing to somebody else. And the next kind of example of an application is something that does that, a distributed application platform. And this is something where it recognizes that this record-keeping system, you don't have to just keep records of who owns something, you can keep records of any data. And I give an example up here. There's a thing called Ethereum, and the data they store in their blockchain is little computer programs. And they're executed whenever you validate a block of these transactions. And what can you do with that? Well, you can make a contract. They do. They call it a smart contract, and it'll say something like, if this event happens, pay some amount of Ether, that's their cryptocurrency, to this other person or this other address. And it'll happen automatically because it's a computer program. So for instance, in our earlier example of me making my ill-considered bet about Andy Dalton, you don't have to worry about that if it's a smart contract because it will execute automatically. You don't need to worry that I'm going to get cold feet or decide I was an idiot to make the contract and repudiate it because it's on the blockchain, you can't modify it, and it's going to execute automatically on validation. You can also use this to create things like sets of rules for an organization. So you can essentially use the Ethereum blockchain, or these blockchains that have more data in them, to create organizations that will run themselves based on the rules, and you have voting protocols saying who puts stuff in, they get to vote how things are allocated. Essentially, anything you can do with a computer can at least theoretically be done on one of these distributed application platforms. I mean, Ethereum is one, there are others, but that's another example of how you can go beyond just cryptocurrencies on the blockchain. Something else that you can do, right, you can do more than just store data, though. You can actually take it off the blockchain and tie it to some kind of ancillary products or services that might provide more incentives to people. And I'm giving an example here. There's a thing called Brave. And Brave has an ancillary technology. It's in the form of a web browser that they say is great, and it also blocks ads. It says no ads of any kind, except for ads that are purchased using a thing called a basic attention token. That's Brave's cryptocurrency, the BAT. And the idea is that when I use my Brave browser and I look at a web page that has one of these Brave ads, the browser will monitor my attention and I will get some portion of the BAT that was paid by the advertiser. So it incentivizes me to look at the ad, and the advertiser likes that. It also incentivizes the advertiser to promote the Brave browser, because then their BAT advertisements will be seen by more people and maybe by more people. And you can also give some of the BAT to the content provider who hosts the ad, so it incentivizes them to have the ad. Everybody's incentivized to sort of promote these BATs and to promote the Brave browser using the same kind of network effects that I talked about earlier with blockchain in general. But now it's not just, I want more people to have Bitcoins, it's actually promoting this whole technology ecosystem. And then the final thing, it's not so much an individual application, well, it's not so much an example as a thing people have been doing with it, which is a really hot alternative to traditional fundraising. It's your initial coin offering. And this can be, I'm going to say, I've got my million coins, and I'm going to release a million coins into the world. And I'm going to hold back 10% because I invented it, so I'm going to do that. But you guys, all of you guys and girls out there, would like to buy the other 90% of my William coins because it's a cryptocurrency, and those are great, and they're extremely hot right now. And of course, it's immutable and has all these other nice effects. And actually, this has been happening a lot, and people are putting a huge amount of money into these initial coin offerings as sort of a funding vehicle. As opposed to, say, the traditional angel VC round. But there's more that I can do than just raise money, right? And that is, by running through an initial coin offering, I can bootstrap adoption of my technology. And think of the Brave example. So if I sell my million William coins, and I have the William browser, the William whatever my ancillary thing is, everyone who buys those is now going to be incentivized to promote my William browser, or William widget, or William whatever it happens to be. And, of course, they're going to be spending their William coins on that, because what else are they going to do with it? I guess hold it for appreciation. But it solves sort of a chicken and egg problem, or it potentially solves sort of a chicken and egg problem that you have with small, with early stage technology things. Because if I'm a merchant, why am I going to buy bats for the Brave browser that nobody's using? But if I'm a merchant that recognizes what happens with blockchains and how these things spread and see that the Brave browser is attached to it, maybe I'm going to give that a second look, even though now it hasn't been adopted by people. So it's an exciting technology, and a lot of people have made a lot of money, but it's not without its drawbacks, and a lot of people have made some mistakes with it. And so I'm going to turn things back over to Matt, and he's going to talk about some more applications, some opportunities, some risks, and some risk management practices that can make your blockchain experiences or the blockchain experiences of those you work with more exciting and fun and less disastrous and business destroying. So there you go, Matt, up to you.
Thank you, William. So, what could go wrong, right? Let's think about it at a high level. We have these ICOs that can give us the opportunity to organize a new business. You know, maybe people buying the 90% of William coins own part of an enterprise. And fundraising can just be selling these William coins and maybe exchanging them for Bitcoin. But remember, Bitcoin, just the owner of a Bitcoin just has to control that number. It's a number. It's not even an identifiable person. So you could fundraise from people that you don't know and you'll never know. So you might decide with one of the autonomous organizations built on Ethereum that your company's going to make decisions. In fact, there was an example of a company that collected a bunch of money and was going to make seed investments in new businesses. And you know, the program in Ethereum determined how to collect the votes and at what thresholds they would assign so much money to a new startup. And that's unheard of. You know, there's no way to do that using traditional technology, at least not as easily, I guess. There are new ways of conducting business, like the Brave browser, and developing new funding for your own enterprise. Escrow is can be automated. Ethereum and a lot of these blockchain inventions are great at disintermediation, at automating the person who just happens to be in the middle in a position of power and putting that out into cyberspace, into a blockchain that is shared and accountable and immutable. So there are a lot of opportunities there. For asset tracking, we could map a specific asset, maybe a car with a VIN number, into a blockchain and track ownership in a way that's public and immutable and gives everybody the ability to know whether your car had been owned before. There are even countries that don't have real estate records like what we have here. You buy a house, you record the deed with the state or the county. They don't have that system, but they can build, using blockchain, a way to record all of the real estate interests in the country in a way that's publicly available
unchangeable, and everybody can see who owns this plot of ground just by accessing this distributed database that everybody has a copy of. Sorry, it's not a great distributed, distributed ledger, let's call it that. That's beautiful. But it's shared, immutable data, and there are lots of opportunities for making new businesses out of that. Documenting business dealings. If I am a manufacturer, an auto manufacturer, I care about where all the parts came from, partly because I might need to justify a tariff level in for the U.S. under a revision of NAFTA, say. And all that documentation can be collected, again, immutably, in a shared database using blockchain applications. That doesn't exist yet. Record keeping between contractual partners is a, kind of a subset of that, I suppose. And just solving problems inherent in these systems, because there are those types of problems. I mean, say we're talking about a computing system with human users and programmatic users that manages electronic value in a whole new way. Well, a computing system, that means that somebody broke it, right? That means that there are bugs. And that means that the abstractions that people talk about when talking about the program might not match the actual implementation. So that would be a problem. And then the bugs. On that, that distributed autonomous organization I mentioned, that again was a real thing. It got up to $150 million in value, and somebody and took $15 million out. So, you know, with humans, there are layers of abstraction on layers of abstraction. Sometimes people lose track of what they really need to be paying attention to, like the private key that signs your Bitcoin wallet. That's it's a chunk of data, like a big long password. And what if you lose it? Well, there's convenience. You could have somebody else hold on to that for you. Use a kind vendor to keep your Bitcoin private key. Boy, yeah. But then sometimes companies get hacked. Sometimes companies aren't honest. And so convenience is really the opposite of security in that kind of situation. But somebody has to manage those bits for those humans. I heard a podcaster who had lucked into a chunk of Bitcoins. His computer that he installed for fun installed the Bitcoin blockchain on. He ended up with 50 Bitcoin really early on in the process. You know, now it's worth a lot of money. But he doesn't know where his private key is. Oh, he's out a lot of money.
$100 million.
Yeah. So, you know, loss is a problem with humans in this new computing system. Of course, there are deceptive people all over. And this is just another tool for them to use that. Well, and with programmatic users, we talked about the DAO. What if there's a problem in the code of Ethereum? The underlying virtual machine that runs those programs that get stored in that blockchain, there's a problem there. That problem applies to all of those token snippets and could be an issue for a lot of people. Well, what do you do with electronic value? And William spoke to the virtual value in some of these currencies and systems. Well, there's worldwide access to it. It's a huge attack surface, I guess is the one way to say it. And it's a new way of doing things. Well, that means that social constructs don't exist yet. People don't know what to expect. Even if everyone is trying to play fair, they don't know what fair really is. They're kind of having to feel it out as these systems get up and running. Sometimes individual expectations are simply unfounded, and cause for conflict, and the law is obviously unprepared for any of this. So I'd say, you know, that's one of the big threats and risks. And even just risks that come from the nature of distributed ledgers and blockchain. The private key is the identity. So if I have my private key on my website accidentally, I thought I was putting my public key up there, I've just given access to all of my assets that are under that private key to anyone who can read my website. And they can impersonate me. They can make bets with William about who's going to be the MVP in the Super Bowl. And actually, I guess I wouldn't mind that. especially if he likes the Bengals so much. So there's loss of assets is an issue and impersonation too. Key management, you know, one solution to putting all your eggs in behind one private key would be having lots of private keys. Keep track of all those private keys. And keeping track of which ones go with what transactions and what systems, that can be difficult. So, well then, start using abstractions, start using key managers, start using third parties to hold your keys to the kingdom and with risk, at least risk. You know, the fact that it's the number that you're doing business with and not necessarily another person, the pseudonymous nature of blockchain-based transactions is an issue. And then timing, like selling one asset, you know, the William coin to me and then selling it to Jill. If he's able to do that in quick succession so that my transaction with him isn't recorded into the blockchain before Jill looks in the blockchain to see if it was done before, and if the two of us don't each wait until that block is buried under other layers of blocks, then we're both paying William money for the same thing, and we're not both going to get it. Then, I guess one variation of blockchains that, that we haven't run into yet is that some blockchains are public, and that's the, like the Bitcoin blockchain, where anybody can develop, can run the software, can run a node that helps with all this computing power, generating signatures and blocks, validating blocks, and storing them for the future. But then there are also alternative systems that aren't so open. Maybe it's just the auto OEM and all of the suppliers. You don't need the public to have access to all this data, but you know, we amongst ourselves have some good reasons for that. So that would be a private blockchain, a blockchain that's not maintained by completely anonymous people. With public blockchain, sometimes decisions have to be made about what's valid, what blocks are valid, just programmatically. But also sometimes things go wrong, like when that distributed autonomous organization blew up and 50 million in Ethereum was stolen from it, the Ethereum community had to decide what to do about that. Are we just going to let that happen? Or what if we all agree that we roll back all those transactions to a certain point and fork the chain in a different direction? It's a good question, and they did, and so now there are two, and you know, they have kind of split value, and they run in parallel, but that kind of consensus in a public blockchain is a risk. It's an issue that, that you should be aware of as you work on these kinds of systems. With a smaller public blockchain, you know, Bitcoin's been going for a long time. You know, it's, I'm sure you know, petaflops of computing cycles are invested every minute, and there's a lot of cycles under there that have layered those blocks on signature, that's not going to be an issue. But what if the brave folks decided that they were going to start their own blockchain? So here's block one, and here's block two, and now somebody catches on and decides they want to mess with the system. They can invest a ton of computing power and develop their own blocks, 1, 2, 3 to 10,000. And now they've completely custom created their own substitute blockchain. And with enough computing power, they can flood the system and take over for a smaller public blockchain. On the private side, you have to manage it. You have to make sure there's access control, like we do in any computing system. There's the possibility of denial of service. What if one participant in the network can't connect to the rest of them? And, you know, they're out. Transactions they try to submit are not reached. So that could be an issue. Overall connectivity between the participants is a problem too. Private key management, we talk about wallets and trusting somebody else or somebody else's software with your private keys, that could be a challenge. Keeping your private keys online versus offline, it's the same with any kind of cryptography. Keeping it offline is less vulnerable to online attacks, but less convenient to use. So that'd be a decision to make. Obviously, the law hasn't caught up enough to decide, well, what the SEC should have a problem with. What if William is really selling interest in his company as an initial coin offering? These tokens that he's selling, these William coins, maybe he's promising that out of the 10,000 William coins, if you own one, you'll get 1/10,000th of the profit made by business X. That's a security, right? So regulatory status on that, you're going to run into trouble, but they're real gray areas and places where there is kind of a business interest, but it's not a traditional security. So what's going to happen? And you don't know until it happens. So the SEC and other organizations are working on it, but they don't have an answer yet. So watch your investments. Not knowing exactly what business with can be an issue too. The DAO, obviously, and yeah, these are programs. There are risks of bugs, and they can have real dramatic effects. Sometimes there's a benefit to opening things up to people who don't have to identify themselves to do business with you. You can reach people who are in oppressive regimes, of one kind or another, in a minority set that would prevent them from participating in transactions normally. So maybe it's good. But if you use pseudonymy to supplement an actual in-person relationship, a real-life business relationship, and just use this as a tool, well, then you've avoided those problems. You're meeting the person. You might exchange keys in person, or public keys in person, like you would with a Signal communication software, to avoid that kind of issue. With bugs, maybe we develop libraries. Maybe there are libraries in Ethereum, in the programming, that everybody else can use. And for just a tiny sliver of an Ethereum unit, you'd be able to use their library and skip the bugs. You know, have it be open source. Have industry consortia write the software, and maybe they even agree how to manage the risk of liability in case there's as far as losing access to your Bitcoin-based assets, it's a new life skill. I think it's just something that we all have to learn. Like we've been told 1,000 times not to click links in emails that look fishy. That's what you gotta do. And so as far as managing private keys, losing control of your digital assets, those are just habits that we have to develop, I think. And then you're combining and balancing online and offline storage, like we would for a good, rigorous password habit. I think that's a good solution. As far as lagging law, it's just got to catch up. Trying to get thinking about it as members of this community, people who know cybersecurity and are interested in the law around cybersecurity, we may be in the best position to help guide legislatures to do it right and do it in a way that makes sense but still leaves open opportunities for business to take advantage of this technology. And then consensus and flooding are our public versus private and blockchain choices. Using established chains can help too with the flooding problem. For access control, it's the standard network access problem, closing ports, controlling access, connection IP addresses of source places, and then connectivity, pardon the speech recognition error there, denial of service problems. We just use mesh networks and create redundancy. Maybe I'm one party in a transaction that's using a private blockchain, and I have multiple locations, different network location and different physical location, that have copies of the database that participate twice in the mesh network, so we can avoid those particular issues. And maybe we can all help make the regulations better. The initial coin offerings kind of have an anti-halo effect right now. I think some of them have been done deceptively, and I think they're getting a bad reputation. But an initial coin offering isn't just an offering of securities using a blockchain. It can be used in tons of different ways. And I think as we develop better language to distinguish between somebody who's offering securities, ownership of a business entity, based on a blockchain asset, find another word for companies that are tokenizing assets and building up a blockchain to manage them. I think we need to develop that vocabulary, and that'll help manage those issues. So really, this is the big opportunity, I think. Solving the problems. We can all see them really at first glance. You can tell where the issues are going to be. So put our brain power to them, and I think that's our big opportunity. Do business with people, use it as a tool, and figure out how to use blockchain-based assets to manage your real assets. And so, we have a few minutes left, about 15 or so. If we want to come back up here and we can take some questions. I'm glad to.
Man, I am so smooth today. I'm not videotaping this.
Yes! You didn't find the chair.
Yeah, in the back. So, with regard to mining Bitcoin, for instance, I got a friend who's now doing this in his spare time. Getting all into it. Where does that, I mean, it could be a fraction of a cent for every transaction that he helps with you, but where does that money actually come from? So for instance, I'm spending one Bitcoin to buy something off of you, we start the transaction, use his computer in order to actually process that. Are you still gonna receive a full Bitcoin, or do you get 99.8% of that?
Yeah, so there is a, so the question is, when someone mines a Bitcoin transaction to validate it, does some portion of that payment go to the miner and be removed from the transferee? The answer is, in practice, yes, some portion will be taken out. It does not have to be. But Bitcoin allows you to say, when I'm posting a transaction, the miner should get this bonus. Like, they should get this percentage of whatever I'm doing, and miners will prioritize those because they want to get their percentage. I don't have to. So I could just say, here's my transaction, and when you mine a Bitcoin, just like a William coin appears out of thin air, when you mine it, the Bitcoin appears out of thin air. So your friend could be awarded a Bitcoin just ex nihilo at that time, but in fact, that's probably not what's going to happen, because anyone who doesn't have the transaction fees, they know they're going to be at the bottom of the list. And so it's more likely to be, yeah, the person who gets the one Bitcoin, if that's what's being transferred, is probably actually going to get 99% of a Bitcoin, or whatever percent is left over after the transaction fee they said they pay.
Ethereum has an interesting alternative system. Each instruction in the program code that gets uploaded in a block has a price on it. You know, each opcode for the CS folks, they all have their own costs. And when you start running a program, part of that submission is the maximum number of gas, it's their unit, you're willing to spend to have somebody run this, validate it. And then when that does get put into a block, put on the chain, that validator gets the benefit of that that gas price.
That's interesting. I think he is doing Ethereum, so.
Okay.
That's good because you actually won't make any, you'll never validate anything on the Bitcoin chain. There are giant server farms in China that do nothing but grind through to find nonsense on the Bitcoin blockchain. And so if he's literally just doing it in his spare time, I mean, the odds of him versus a giant dedicated server farm is, I mean, you might as well be waiting to get struck by lightning.
Yeah, he's got
The mentioning the Bitcoin bonds brings up something kind of interesting that I was just now reading about, was this, the risk of a bit farm cartel basically controlling more than 50% of the processing power and being able to sort of control the way that the transactions are written because of that. And there's a, I don't know that that's, people, you know, when you search, people say various things about whether that's feasible or not. But that is a risk that people have certainly recognized and wondered how they would address it if they come up.
I had a question. Can you speak to a little bit about how the government stands behind fiat money versus, you know, you touched upon the SEC, the regulation, but really, you know, one of the charms of Bitcoin and blockchain is its open, transparent nature, and there's no really government, you know, and if you look at it, you're getting the Federal Reserve technically out of the monetary system. And that's, you know, for people who've read the book, my brother's all laid out with this stuff, The Creature from Jekyll Island, you know, that's really alluring. But can you speak to the risks? I mean, if this continues to, you know, get more and more powerful, more and more crash, do you think governments across the globe would jump in and try to regulate it and put controls with it?
Repeat the question.
The question is, will governments jump in and hyper-regulate or regulate, period, how will they regulate, is probably the better question, cryptocurrencies? Because cryptocurrencies are really established and operated and traded independently of any government. And I'm sure they will. I think there are bills percolating in the US Congress for managing cryptocurrency transactions, really just adapting current regulations to cover cryptocurrency transactions at a comparable level. So if you're transferring $10,000 or more in value, even if it's in cryptocurrency, you have to report that just like you would if you transferred $10,000. I think that parity is where we're at here. The Chinese government has cut off cryptocurrency, and ICOs is what they completely nixed. They said, we're not doing that here. I think there will be overreaction, underreaction, and market effects that come from the benefit of working in some jurisdictions or not.
I actually want to add a little bit onto that. I think, right, as Matt said, we do have some governments saying no, right? ICOs are just unlicensed securities offerings in China, so you can't do that. And I think that's one thing. What's really going to, I think, be the biggest issue on this is what he mentioned right before that, which is applying traditional anti-money laundering and bank secrecy type of laws to the blockchain.
Know your customer.
Particularly know your customer, because since it's all public or private keys and public keys, and there are some blockchains which are designed to even not have that level of identity management. And what happens when some regulator says, well, wait a minute, you have to have a blockchain that tracks who you're going to, or so that we can know if you're sending it to a terrorist organization.
Yep.
And then someone says, well, wait a minute, my Zcash, I have no idea, and I can't know. Is that regulator or senator, who maybe comes from a district where there was a terrorist attack, or maybe they got in because they had a family member who was killed in a terrorist attack and they're very sympathetic and they care about it a lot, is that legislator going to say, well, I understand this is a new technology, and therefore the fact that you're trying that you can't know that you're sending this to Al-Qaeda, I'm going to just give you a pass? Or are they going to say, you better find a way or I'm going to make possession of your blockchain illegal? I don't know what they're going to do. But I do know that I've seen other cases where technology has butted up against regulatory interests, particularly national security, and technology doesn't have a great record in those fights. Now it does in the end, right? PGP, where the encryption software says, "Oh, you can't export this." They said, "Oh, too late." But you know, that's that would definitely fall on the risk side of it. And my idea for mitigating is to I guess be a little bit realistic. What is the regulator going to want to do?
And reasonably want to do,
right? There are reasons why you might want to have restrictions on things that would prevent someone from ever applying anti-money laundering regulations. Is that something you want to be doing, or is there a way you want to modify that so that when you sell something to someone, you actually do have records of who they are? All interesting questions, but I think that's going to be the really exciting, interesting part, because these are so different. Right, from a regular database, from a regular bank transaction, where I have to know your bank number, your routing number, and here, I might not know who you are or where you are, or anything about it.
Well, I was even thinking about a subpoena. If you get a subpoena, where are you going to get your financial records?
Yeah.
Another interesting question.
Yep.
Yes.
What about taxation? I mean, governments are going to want to tax these transactions.
Right.
How are they going to, you know where, whether they even have nexus to tax them.
Right.
What, is there any
like you're saying, in some systems, there's just no way to know.
Yep.
No way to know.
Yes, as a talk about business opportunity, and this may already be happening or thought of, but so you see like banks saying, hey, look, you know, you have a private key that's on your computer, it's very hackable, you have $1 million in your Bitcoin. Give it to us. We're a bank. We're very secure, and we'll hold it for you in secret file.
Yeah. So the question was: is there a business opportunity for people basically holding private keys in a very secure way, like a bank? And the answer is yes. There are businesses already doing that. I read about one, the name of which escapes me at the moment, and Matt, chime in if you recall it. But they say we store your private keys in a vault under like a kilometer. It's like dug into the surface of the earth, and it's shielded from all forms of radiation, and no one can possibly ever touch it. And of course, the fun part, the punchline to all this is, yes, that puts you at one kind of risk, but if you're ever going to transact with it, it's got to come out of that vault and be used in some way. So there is definitely a business opportunity that people are already jumping on, and it's made enough money to justify digging extremely deep holes. But you know, there's still a lot in that area of risk mitigation, because just because you solve one risk, there's still a lot out there, and I don't think anyone solved the whole problem yet. Matt, if you know.
I don't remember. I've never heard that. All right. Thank you, everyone.